Now, when it comes to wireless communication, cellular networks and Wi-Fi have often been seen as competing technologies. And indeed, there are significant areas of overlap between the two. But what, of course, we must remember is that for cellular networks, they are designed to cover a much wider area than Wi-Fi. But with the advent of private cellular networks, they can also occupy the space in terms of providing localized connectivity for a particular organization, for example, that Wi-Fi currently occupies. Now, as we move to a more connected future, what we can expect to see is this idea of pervasive or ubiquitous connectivity. And ultimately, as part of that, what we are likely to see is a combination of cellular and Wi-Fi technologies. Indeed, with 5G, we're already seeing some integration with Wi-Fi. We have the ability to carry out Wi-Fi calling, and we have the ability to interwork, so interworking between Wi-Fi and 5G networks. So really, it's no longer a case of friend or foe in terms of the relationship between the two. Now, if we think of the kind of traditional concept, traditional ideas of where we would expect to see and use each technology, well, it's fairly clearly defined at present. So we might expect to use Wi-Fi in the home. But of course, in areas where broadband coverage is quite patchy, we may see fixed wireless access use. So 5G is effectively used to provide internet connectivity to the home. So this is an area where we are already seeing that kind of that convergence or that overlap. In the car, we might expect to be using cellular technology. As you know, we're on the morning commute, for example. We'll use cellular technology to access real-time traffic information, to access music streaming services, and so on. And then we can see, as we arrive at the office, it may be that we then switch to Wi-Fi. And of course, there are enhancements in place in 5G to allow that seamless offload between the 5G network and Wi-Fi to make the user experience better. And then we might see, you know, in a social environment, after work, for example, again, we're onto using the cellular network. In a hotel setting, we might check in, go to our room, and first of all, sign into the Wi-Fi network. And there may be reasons for us to do this. Cellular coverage may not be acceptable for the data rates that are desired. There may be a desire to limit the amount of data consumed on a cellular connection. And many other reasons why you may prefer to use the hotel Wi-Fi, for example. And then, of course, we have the issue of roaming. So 5G user leaves the country, moves to a different country. They have the ability to then roam onto a visited network and access data services that way. And of course, the alternative here, if the coverage is present, for example, in a hotel in a different country, for example, we can, of course, use Wi-Fi. So what we're really seeing and the kind of picture that emerges really is of two kind of quite interwoven technologies that we can expect to see even tighter integration as we move forward in terms of building scalable private wireless networks. So in terms of some of the overlaps then, just to kind of summarize where we might see both technologies used then. So we've discussed indoor and outdoor. Now, in terms of outdoor coverage, Wi-Fi clearly is going to be inferior to cellular, certainly on medium to long distance, in medium to long distances. We've got voice and video services that can be delivered via both mediums. Private networks, which really is the kind of focus for us. Now, in terms of providing private network coverage, really Wi-Fi is currently the king. But of course, it has limitations in terms of the distance that it can cover. And some of the enhancements that are provided by 5G may be more suitable for private networks in things such as industrial settings, for example. And we have seen lots of pilot projects utilizing private 5G networks really to take advantage of some of the low latency and the additional enhancements provided by 5G over and above the capabilities of Wi-Fi. We've got data offload. So as I discussed earlier, it may be that, you know, you move to a location with your mobile handset, you then move on to Wi-Fi coverage, and thus, you know, we're no longer using the cellular network for data. IoT, Internet of Things devices. So we might see this utilized in a smart home or a smart workplace environment, for example. And certainly within the smart home environment, we would expect to see Wi-Fi as the dominant technology, since for most people, their internet connectivity is provided by a Wi-Fi router in the home. But of course, we've talked about lots of IoT deployments that can utilize 5G, certainly in longer range environments that require greater coverage, So if we think about smart cities, for example, where we may see huge volumes of sensors, each with their own connectivity, deployed across a wide environment, well, clearly here, a private or even a public cellular network would be the better option. We've got technologies such as augmented reality, virtual reality, so real-time communication that require very low levels of latency to provide an acceptable quality of experience for the user. And then we've got streaming. So again, similar to video, we can access streaming services both via cellular data, but also via Wi-Fi. In many cases at present, people may prefer to perhaps pre-download things such as videos and music prior to going on their commute, for example, because this reduces data usage across the mobile network. And we must remember, for lots of subscribers, there will be limits on the amount of data that they can consume via the cellular network. And then finally, we have mobility. And we can see it perhaps is an area where 5G and cellular has the edge, since, you know, we're not tethered down to a fixed location. We have coverage available wherever the public network is available. Now, when it comes to private networks, there may be less to pick between the two technologies. Clearly, with Wi-Fi mesh technologies, coverage can be extended in much the same way that we can with cellular. But of course, we have some of those additional capabilities that 5G enables. And certainly, as we look towards the next generation of mobile technology, we can expect to see newer enhancements aimed at supporting additional use cases across a number of different market verticals in private networks. Okay, so moving on then to look at some key characteristics. So really, we're talking about the current generation of technology here. So we can see we're comparing 5G and Wi-Fi 6. Now, with the caveat that obviously we've got some enhancements for 5G to come, and we've also got Wi-Fi 7 on the horizon. So in terms of frequency band then, typically we'll see 5G deployed in either frequency range 1 or frequency range 2. Wi-Fi, most of us are probably familiar with the industrial, scientific and medical bands of 2.4, 5 and 6 gigahertz. Moving on to channel bandwidth and a maximum channel bandwidth. So we can see there 5G really has the edge utilizing technologies such as carrier aggregation to create larger channel bandwidths and thus greater data rates. Access technology, so Wi-Fi and 5G, both very similar with some very slight differences in the implementation. So both use orthogonal frequency division multiple access. And then finally, in terms of modulation, so typically with 5G, we'll see around 256 QAMs, or quadrature amplitude modulation, with Wi-Fi 6 capable of up to 1024. So in this area, Wi-Fi certainly has the edge, but what we must remember here is this is over a much shorter range. So cellular networks, 5G, need support much greater coverage. So there is the ability to change the modulation scheme, so to increase data rates by changing the modulation scheme to a higher order modulation, such as that seen in Wi-Fi. And certainly with further developments in 5G and future networks, we can expect to see that modulation number increase. And of course, finally, as I mentioned already, we've got 5G Advanced and we've got Wi-Fi 7. So we must bear in mind that these figures are not fixed and we can expect them to improve for both Wi-Fi and for 5G. Okay, looking specifically then at private network applications. So as I mentioned earlier, Wi-Fi tends to dominate in terms of private environments, mainly because it's easy to deploy. There is a large wealth of experience when it comes to deploying and managing Wi-Fi networks. But there are a number of enhancements that can be provided by private cellular networks. And as I previously mentioned, there are lots of test cases that we've seen already that have been able to utilize the potential of 5G in environments such as logistics hubs, factories, other industrial production facilities, for example. So if we take a look then at what we mean by private 5G. So we can differentiate this from the use of the public network, since a private 5G network will utilize radio hardware that is used exclusively within this particular organization or on this particular site. And we can see there may be a number of different applications for this. So if we think about environments such as factories where we use lots of automation, we may expect to see lots of sensors and actuators deployed throughout that environment, all of which may require connectivity to report metrics, or even for general operation. So in terms of a definition then, so this is about providing 5G coverage and 5G network services to a clearly defined organisation or a set of organisations. So you may think, well, why 5G over Wi-Fi? Well, if we think about some of the specific characteristics of 5G, so the ability to support a greater amount of user, greater connection density, for example. So in a large production environment, we might expect to see lots and lots of machinery. And if each piece of machinery has multiple sensors on each reporting via the private 5G network, then 5G is needed to support that volume of users. And there are a number of additional enhancements that would support the use of a private cellular network over the use of Wi-Fi. Now, in terms of some key characteristics then. So we've got both virtual and physical elements. So core services may be provided on the location, are software-based services, as we see in the 5G core, combined with physical radio hardware on location. There are several different deployment models. So as we can see in the top right, we can also have connectivity with the public network, for example. And this would necessitate strict security measures, but it doesn't necessarily need to be an isolated network. So there is the capability to connect to the public network for access to additional services, for example. We can control access for UEs on a much more granular level than we can with Wi-Fi. So it may be that for particular devices, we want to restrict access to a particular service, we want to limit performance capabilities. We may want to assign additional resources to a particular UE and give priority. Well, as I say, we have much more granular control with our private 5G network. And then finally, we have lots of different solution providers able to provide often turnkey solutions to support organizations in the deployment of private cellular networks. So it doesn't need to be a limitation that, okay, there's a lot of expertise out there in terms of Wi-Fi, but there are lots of solutions available for private cellular networks. So now let's take a look at some key use cases for private 5G networks. Now, of course, with many of these, there will be significant overlap with Wi-Fi. So, for example, residential. The majority of homes will contain some Wi-Fi connectivity that are connected to the internet. However, as I mentioned earlier, this may be provided by fixed wireless access. So it may be a 5G service providing cellular connectivity. And this would really come under what we would call fixed wireless access, but ultimately is the same underlying concept as a private 5G network. Mission critical. So for use cases where we have mission critical communication requirements, so this may be in safety systems, this may be in subterranean environments such as mines, for example, or in emergency scenarios, mission critical is absolutely essential, and we need to ensure that whatever system we deploy for our network is capable of supporting the performance requirements of mission critical communication. Next, we've got Industry 4.0, a really kind of broad, all-encompassing term that covers really a large range of different applications within industrial environments. So we see things such as robotics, AR and VR, we see sensors, we see automated guided vehicles, for example. Now, each of these may have different performance requirements and may need finer control than what we might see with a Wi-Fi network. We've got high capacity venues, so things such as sports stadiums, for example, that may provide additional coverage options for their users. So in a sports stadium, it may support up to 80,000 spectators, for example. Well, clearly, although we see Wi-Fi deployed in these environments, it may be that private 5G is a much more scalable option when it comes to these environments. And on campus settings, and again, this covers a wide range of different locations. So we might see this in an enterprise environment. We might see this in an academic or military environment, for example, each of which will have their own individual needs in terms of what the network supports. So again, we see a significant amount of overlap with Wi-Fi, but we must remember we've got that much finer control and we can cover a much larger area with a private cellular network, since it's a wide area network technology out of the box. And although we can extend the coverage of Wi-Fi, it isn't principally what it was designed for. So in terms of advantages of 5G in private networks, so we've got ultra-reliable and low-latency communication. We've got improved spectral efficiency. We've got improved quality of service and much more granular control over quality of service. We've got the ability to carry out network slicing, and that is that we can create separate virtualized end-to-end instances of our network. So it may be that we assign a network slice in our private network to for the needs of machinery, for example. We might have another network slice that's dedicated to mission-critical communications, for example. So we can tailor the performance of each slice individually. We've got support for multiple access edge computing. So, you know, we talked about that connectivity to the public 5G network, but what we may see is connectivity to resources that are deployed at the edge of the public network. So this may be suitable for things such as IoT offload, for example, where, you know, we may wish to carry out some analysis using AI or machine learning on the data generated by our IoT devices in the private network. And we may want to offload that processing to the edge of the network, ultimately with the goal that the data will be aggregated and then perhaps processed by another service in the cloud. We've got API exposure, so we can expose access to additional services that can be accessed programmatically and used to kind of extend the capabilities of the network. And we've got flexible numerology, which is a little bit beyond the scope of this video, but it gives us some flexibility in terms, or more flexibility than Wi-Fi, in terms of how radio resources are allocated. So finally, it's worthwhile for us to take a look at the performance characteristics of Wi-Fi 7. So we can see then in terms of frequency bands, very much the same as what we see already, the ISM bands. Now with channel bandwidth, so Wi-Fi 6 will max out at 160 megahertz, but Wi-Fi 7 has support for up to 320 megahertz. And of course, this will increase data rates. Now, in terms of MIMO, multiple input, multiple output streams, we can support both single user and multi-user. And we can see that in terms of uplink and downlink, this has increased, this has doubled from Wi-Fi 6. The access technology remains the same. And again, this is the same as what we see in 5G, so orthogonal frequency division multiple access. Now, in terms of modulation schemes, now we touched upon this earlier. Now, Wi-Fi 7 has the capability to support up to 4,096 QAM. So in other words, we're able to squeeze more data into our radio resource utilizing these higher order modulation schemes. And what this will allow Wi-Fi 7 to do is to really increase and drive up data rates. So we can see that the peak rate on the physical layer is 46 gigabits per second. We can expect to see an effective throughput of around 20 gigabits per second, which really kind of puts it in the range of what we may see in future sixth generation networks, for example. So overall then, it's clear to see that both technologies have their benefits. And as we move towards a more connected future where we can expect connectivity to be absolutely everywhere, to be pervasive or ubiquitous, it's clear that these two different technologies that may once upon a time have been seen as competing technologies really are much more, have a much more symbiotic and collaborative relationship. Now, in terms of building scalable communications networks of the future, it's likely that we may see a combination of the two technologies.